Yes.
Hi everyone, I'm Nikhil Mittal and I'm presenting on hacking with human interface devices. Welcome to the Hardware Hacking Village. A couple of things about me. I'm a hacker. Still not audible? A bit louder. I'm a hacker. I'm a trainer. I speak at conferences. I maintain two open source toolkits, Kautilya and Nishan. So Kautilya is the toolkit which we are going to have a look at today. It could be used to generate ready-to-use sketches for Arduino-like devices. And those sketches could be used for penetration testing or breaking into machines if you are authorized to do so. This is my Twitter handle and that is my blog, so follow me. I'm a sucker for followers. I'm generally interested in offensive information security and new ways to get into systems. And I've spoken at a couple of conferences previously as well. So what we are going to have a look at today is why should we use human interface devices? What is a human interface device? And obviously a lot about my tool. We will also see some live demonstrations and hope they work. I've just tested everything in the morning. So if something doesn't work, assume and trust me. And at last we will talk about a couple of defenses against these attacks. So, I missed a slide. What is a human interface device? So, those of you who don't know it, it is something. So, we as humans interface with computers using different things like mouse, keyboard, touch, joystick. A human interface device is something which allows us to do that. For example, a keyboard is a HID, a mouse is a HID, and so on. So, why should we use these things in penetration tests? First and foremost thing, they are really powerful, as we'll see in a few minutes. Countermeasures like antivirus, HIPS, security teams, they trust these devices. For example, when you plug in a programmable keyboard, it's obviously detected as a keyboard. And I've rarely seen any corporate environment or one of any of my clients who block keyboards to be attached to their machines. A lot of people block mass storage devices, but no one really cares about keyboards. And the last thing is, it's really cheap. So device I'm going to use, it's a TNC 3.0 from pgrc.com. It's just like $20-$22 device. So you can literally use dozens of them in your penetration test gigs. There are so many HIDs or human interface devices which hackers can use. I've listed a couple of them which are really cheap and small in size. For example, TNC, which I'm going to use today, OpenCuBOS, Arduino Micro, and a lot more devices. I mean, in fact, I've not listed here of them. There are so many devices. Just keep in mind that if you really want to use them in penetration tests, the physical size should be smaller. For example, I've seen using guys Arduino Duo as a human interface device, but it's like this big, at least this big, like size of a palm. So it could not be easily hidden inside the other devices. So about my toolkit, Kautilya, it is named after some Indian guy who was a political thinker back there. So just do not think about it. It is written in Ruby and it's available on my GitHub. It contains like 54 payloads right now, 45 for Windows, 5 for Linux, and 4 for OS X. So your mileage may vary on OS X because I just ported it on VMware. I own a PC, I work on Windows technologies, but Windows payloads should be quite stable. Kautilya currently supports TNC++ 2.0 and TNC 3.0. So as you will see, we can just input some things to this tool, and it has an old school GUI menu driven thing. Okay, I'm scared of this thing. I'm still audible? Yeah, that's fine. Okay, and because Arduino supports only TNC devices, there has been a port of Cotillia for Arduino Micro by some awesome guy. So you can check that one as well. And that brings us to the pentest scenarios. So we'll be having a look at these things. So these are the things which I've tested today. There are a lot more things which you can do with Cotillia. If there is any user of Cotillia, you can ask for a demonstration and I'll do that right now. And the target I'm going to use is a Windows 7. It's not pirated. It's a demo version, but its activation has, it shows that it is not activated. So do not think that it is a pirated one. I just created that like 30-40 days back and it has expired a couple of days back. So it's not a pirated thing. Do not complain to Microsoft, please. So this is going to be our target. What we are going to do is we program our HID and connect it to this target and let's see what happens. So this is our device, TNC 3.0. As you can see, the target must be unlocked. Only in that case you can use this. I mean, it works even if the target is locked, but you won't be able to type anything. So the target must be unlocked. And this is not a pirated version. Okay, so this would be our target. And this is how Cotillia looks. It looks a bit ugly here. It is designed and developed on Ubuntu, but I'm using it on Windows right now. If you have Ruby installed on Windows, you can use this on Windows as well. So our first pentest scenario is getting access to a target environment. And we would use a couple of reverse shells, that is the shells which connect back to us. And the target, which is this machine, it is in a fairly restricted environment. On port TCP, only 80 and 443 are allowed. On UDP, only 53 and only ICMPv4. So that's quite a restricted environment. So Cotillia has a really old school GUI. You have to enter your options like this. Is it visible to the back? You save one here. Sorry. Then the shells are in the execute category. We press 2. Then we have 11 options for shells. Let's use a reverse TCP, which is the 7th one. It shows a small help and the options you can enter. So right now it is asking for the IP address to which the reverse shell will connect back. And now the port. So let's use 443 because it is generally allowed through the firewalls. And now it asks for the type of board you want to use. So let's go for TNC 3. And it has created a sketch which could be used in the Arduino IDE. And the sketch is in the output directory of Cotillia. So let's just open that. Okay. So this is our sketch. We'll just either open it in IDE, Arduino IDE, or just copy it and paste it here. So now I'll connect the device. First I will upload the sketch to it. And because there is a sketch already loaded on it, first I have to stop the device after inserting it. So I'll just disable the auto reboot and stop the device. Whoa, it started working. Okay, so now the device is now ready. Now we can upload our sketch to this device. just press upload. Just a more, okay. No, stop. Okay, I believe the sketch has been uploaded. Let's just try it out. So I entered the IP address of my host machine and put 443. So let's start a listener on it. Okay. So I'm going to use PowerCat, which is a netcat port to PowerShell, or you can use your netcat on Linux as well. So it's our choice. In fact, let's use netcat. So for that, I need to just change the IP address. Is it gone? No. So this is IP of this Kali Linux running over here. Let's start. Let's start a listener on port 443. And now if I connect this device to the VM, that is our target. Let's see if it works. So what it will do first, if it is for the first time it is being used on a machine, it waits for the drivers, then it minimizes everything, then opens up a really small command prompt, types in dark blue on black so that it is less visible, and does the stuff. Okay. So let me just disconnect and reconnect it. Okay. Let's see if it gets detected. So the idea behind this thing is you can program it as a keyboard and it can type really fast and without errors. So in internal gigs, you can assume it as you have access to a machine and you want to really fastly add a user and do something like that, then this device is for you. And okay. We just reburn it to the device because it was the different IP address previously. So how I use it in external pen test gigs is I take a couple of dozen of these things, hide them inside either thumb drives or USB toys and things like that, and then I drop it in my clients' parking lots, cafeterias, etc., or near the office, and the success rate has been quite high, like 30-40%. So that's really, really good, because once you have access to even a single machine, you are in. So let's see if right now we have something. Oh, it sucks. Okay. Let me start a PowerCat listener. Okay, so it drops PowerShell scripts in the temp directory of the user. So because this is not working right now, let me check that script, if it there's something wrong with the script. I'm I'm trying to make it fileless, but right now, this is what it does. So it dropped these PowerShell script and VB script in the temporary directory of the user. And I know what's wrong with this. Nice, it connects to my, okay, look, it's there. So it took some time, I'm sorry. So we have this interactive PowerShell connect back from the target machine. It took some time. So now we can run the native commands or PowerShell commandlets as well, whatever you want. And once you have a PowerShell session, you can really, like in a couple of seconds, upgrade it to a Metapeter. Or in fact, only using PowerShell, you can do really cool stuff. And I do a training for that, so please join that. So this is a reverse TCP proxy aware shell. You can use it over internet, in your external gigs, or whatever. Another thing I would like to show you is a reverse ICMP shell. Please note that reverse ICMP shell is not tunneling anything. So if someone is looking at the network, I'm sorry to say, he will see everything, your commands, your responses. I'm working on encoding things. Right now the problem is, if you encode at least base 64 encode things, they would be so huge that you will generate malformed ICMP packets. So that is not what we want. So is this good? I'm going to close this shell. Okay. So if you want to have a look at it, just in case you don't feel like that, it's off, I'm sorry. I'll just turn this on. And if you see, we have only a couple of outbound rules. Let's enable outbound ICMP as well. So for an ICMP reverse shell, we'll again go to payload for Windows, execute, and then now let's select the reverse ICMP shell option. Or if you want, I can show reverse HTTPS shell as well. So the reverse HTTPS shell is a certificate paint completely encrypted shell. So really hard to detect. Let's see both of them. Okay, so 9. Notice that in this case, you must have the listener on a Linux machine because you cannot turn off ping replies on Windows. So this is my Kali Linux, couple of other options, and we have a sketch. Let's just copy this sketch to the Arduino IDE and let's just upload it to the device. Now we must start a listener, and if you notice the help here, it shows the command you need to execute on your Linux machine to turn off ping replies. So let me just copy this. So we have stopped ping replies by the OS. It's our server which will reply to the pings. And we need, as a server, we need the server from ICMP SH toolsuit. So let's start that. So now our server is listening for ICMP probes. Now, if I reboot the device that is connected to the victim, it again will open up a command prompt and type some stuff. Because in case of Windows, most of the payloads are in PowerShell in conjunction with VBScript. And as I will show you in a couple of minutes, to get away from the USC prompt, it uses some neat trick. When it needs to open an elevated shell, for example, to dump user passwords in plain, it uses the... Okay, so we have a reverse PowerShell shell here. For example, let's run Who Am I again. So this is completely over ICMP. Let's just exit this one. Yeah. So that was our first pen test use case, reverse shells or shell or shells from Windows machines. Let's use this second one. For example, in a social engineering campaign, you may be asked to gather user credentials in plain. So let's try that. So for that, you need to go to the gathered category, which is one. And then the ninth one, which is dump passwords in plain. So what this script does is it needs to pull Mimikatz ported into PowerShell, which is a script called invoke Mimikatz. It needs to pull it from the internet. That's a bad part. It executes it in memory on the target, dumps passwords, and paste it back or exfiltrate it to whatever you want. So let's use our local web server. So this is the URL of our script. We need not pass any argument. And let's exfiltrate to our own local web server. So that would be option number three. Post request to your own website or web server. And that is my Kali Linux. And that is it. So we have a sketch. Let's just open that sketch, paste it here, and upload it to the device. And now if I run, connect this device or reboot it here. Now the mode of operation would be a bit different. It will open up an elevated shell because that script, obviously like any other method, needs administrative access to do that. But I don't think this user has administrative access. Let's see, I don't know. I think this user, okay, I don't know. Okay, it does that. Okay. So now it presses left arrow and Y to say yes to this USC prompt. And that thing right now is an elevated shell. So it types the PowerShell code for downloading a script which we specified and executing it. The time it takes prior to closing this is because of it waits if the drivers needs to be installed. Also, it has a reliability check that if a user clicks in between when it is typing, it restarts the process. Okay, so As you can see, it was downloaded from my local web server and should be executed. Let's check. Okay, it is, it should be this. So this is obviously an encoded output. Let's just copy this. So Kautilya in the extras directory has scripts to decode things. So it has written the decoded data to decoded.txt. And now if I open it, you can see that we have password in plain for that user. So it's quite powerful, but you must have internet access to pull the script. Right now what I am working on is to mount an SD card over this device which pulls the scripts from it, so that we need not depend on access to an external web server in case of large scripts. So we used, we downloaded the script here because it is so huge that if, I don't think the device would be able to hold that, and if, even if it holds that, it would take so much time to type that out, which is non-practical. So that was just another case. Okay, the third one is, obviously I cannot show it at DEF CON because both of these are my favorite ones. Not really practical, but really cool. For example, this one, the first one, which means Gupt, which means secret in my language, that reads SSID names. So the idea behind that thing is, it looks for a specifically crafted SSID name, and the command which it needs to execute, the target needs to execute, is within that SSID name. That is, it never connects to that network. So there are slight chances that of WIPS or any Wi-Fi countermeasure may detect or may not detect it. So I'll show you how to configure it, but obviously I cannot run it here. So these are the backdoors available. So this is how it works. You need to specify a magic string, a 4-character magic string. If I go by the example in the payload itself, or nothing. Okay, so what happens now if I connect it to a target is it will look for an SSID whose name, whose first 4 characters are open, and if the 5th character is C for command, then the rest of the SSID name up to 32 characters is considered a command. For example, if I run this on my machine and you start a hotspot called openc who am I, it will execute who am I on the target. And to execute scripts, unfortunately, because SSID names are limited to 32 characters, you have to specify open u and the shortened path of Google URL shortener. So it takes that URL shortener, expands it, and pulls down the script from there. So I like it because it looks cool, but not really practical unless you are sitting with a targeted antenna in a cafe across road of your client, which is always possible. So okay, I cannot show the next one as well, the Rogue AP. So I can explain what it does. A Windows 7 and onwards, there's a feature of hosted wireless networks. So what this Rogue AP does is this. You can provide a SSID which would be created, which would be used on the target machine. And then there is a Metaprinter bind started on the machine. So it is like you have a SSID with proper key on the target, and you can connect to it, and as soon as you connect to it, there would be a bind metapita. This payload adds firewall exceptions as well. So there would be a bind metapita listening for it. You can just connect to it. So that you have a private network on a single machine with a metapita session. So again, because my VM does not have a Wi-Fi card, unfortunately I'm not carrying an external one. So I have to create it on my machine, so I'm not doing that. And so just close this. Okay. What else? We can drop infected files as well. Again, in case of Windows, a PowerShell allows a lot of things to do. So we can drop a Word, Excel, compile help file, LNK, the shortcut files on the target, which are infected. Word and Excel files use auto-executable macros. So if there is something which detects auto-executable macros, it will catch that. But I've not seen any AV flagging it yet. So we can use it. Another thing is, as far as I know and I tried, it is not programmatically possible to password protect your macros. So someone can open it and have a look at your macro. So let's just try this one out. Okay, I forgot the HTTPS. So I'll demonstrate the HTTPS shell first. I just missed that. So this is our listener, so this needs to be executed on the attacker's machine. And this is Windows specific right now. So we have a listener running on our attacker machine. Let's choose 10, which is reverse HTTPS shell. And the IP address of our machine and the port. Now let's just paste it here, upload it to the device. And now if I connect it to the target, let's see if it works. So it is one of the smallest payloads in Cortilla. Just two lines needs to be typed on the target, so it's really fast. Doesn't need administrative privileges or anything like that. No, it didn't work. Okay. No, it's perfect. It should work. Uh-huh. Okay, could be some issue with the payload. Let's not waste time on it. Keep one thing in mind, that if you're trying to use this with Arduino, you must install TeamCDuino and things. So that is a detail written in detail on the website of these vendors. Make sure that you use the correct board, this which is in this case TeamC3.0, and the USB type. So these two things should be kept in mind. Okay, that could be firewall here. Just let me see if I have allowed port 443 or not. Okay, it's allowed. So it should work. I don't know why it didn't work. Didn't want to. Okay. Again, sorry, it took time. So this is a completely encrypted certificate pinned session. It should work. Okay. So this was a reverse HTTPS shell. Now on to dropping infected files. Let's test. So the idea behind dropping infected file is just to have another way of breaking into a system. For example, if you can have a reverse shell, there is no need to basically drop files on the target, but let's see it anyways. So these are the options which we have with us. Let's go for MS Word. So it asks for a PowerShell one-liner or native command, whatever you want. So let's use a reverse shell, a one-liner reverse shell. Let's see if that works. Okay. So you can always copy it from here. And let me copy a one-liner reverse shell which connects back to again 443. So if you want, you can change the name of the file as well. And if you see the sketch, you will see that it is nothing but just a simple PowerShell script which drops the file on the target. So let's just try this thing out. I need to execute this on the local machine because there's no MS Office on the target. So let me just reboot it here. So it will drop that file on the user's desktop. Hopefully. So it is a good thing to have if you want, just want a different way to stay in a client's machine or in a target machine. So the Word file, this one, is the infected one. And okay. If I start, okay, let me start a new one. I have to start a listener before I open that file. Whoa. Okay, no. Let me just close this one. So it connected back actually. This is how our infected file worked, and hopefully we will have a reverse shell here. The flip side with this thing is this. Anyone can go to the macros and see what we are up to. So if you're really using it in a social engineering campaign, then you have to password protect it. Otherwise, anyone would be able to see. For example, if you're downloading a script, anyone looking at the macro would be able to see your IP address. That's a flip side. Okay, maybe it is taking time. Let's come back to it in a couple of minutes. Okay, a reverse metaprinter. So there are two ways of getting a reverse metaprinter using this thing. The first one is, which we saw a couple of minutes back, get a reverse PowerShell and use it to upgrade it to a metaprinter. Or you can use this one, okay, 6, which is execute shellcode. So you need just create a shellcode using MSF Venom, paste it to, okay, not this one, sorry. Not this one. It is, okay, sorry, it is the first one. So you can create, so MSF Venom supports creating metaprinter in PowerShell. You can just create that and execute it on the target and you will be fine. I'm not going to demonstrate that. We have already seen so many reverse shells. So defenses against these things. So you can always control installation of devices using group policies. But I have seen in real corporate environments and in my clients, what they do, they at max, they block mass storage devices and nothing else. So if someone is really smart enough and blocks installation of any hardware device or hardware device by class, then this thing could be blocked. But if someone is using, for example, so many antivirus vendors block devices by VID, vendor ID and product ID. You can always change that by going here. Okay, in Arduino. Okay. Hardware, TNC, cores, and okay, this one. No, not this one. I believe it's this one. So it's there on my blog. I'm not able to recall it right now. Okay, here it is. So you can always change these vendor ID and product ID. So if there is, you know that there is an antivirus or any endpoint protection which blocks a particular VID and PID, you can always mimic a HP keyboard or Microsoft keyboard or whatever you want. So you can just change it here. So there's a list of vendor IDs and PIDs on USB.org and so many websites. So one defense is to on Windows machines is to use group policy, on Linux is to use UDEV. But the best thing is just put glue on in all the USB ports but one and lock that USB device to the machine. So that's the best defense. If you have USB ports open, there are so many devices, as we saw a couple of minutes back, you can do really nasty things with them. And the best thing is to make your employees aware of the risks of attaching untrusted or new USB devices to their work machines. I mean, I've seen like in one of my pen test gigs, this device didn't work. So it was, I used it that way that I used a 2-port USB hub and connected the toy and the device together inside the toy, and there was a single cable coming out of it. So it didn't work on one of the guys' machine, so they connected in their colleague's machine, and I got like 3 shells from a single device. So employee awareness is the best defense. And couple of closing remarks. Bad guys are already using it. I have myself seen this with couple of clients getting hacked by this thing. Even good guys are using it. It's not really something groundbreaking. And as long as operating systems and system administrators and countermeasures keep trusting things, these things will work, because security ends with trust. Okay, so some shameless self-promotion. I do a training for this thing, so have a look at it on my blog, and these are my contact details. You can find Kautilya on my GitHub. So there's another tool, open source tool I mentioned, you can find it there as well. So that was all. Any questions? No questions? Thank you.